Men seems to share certain anatomical features. Their gender is socially and culturally determined. So what is manly in one society would not be considered manly in others. That is what it means. And this is where feminism and gender theory seems to converge. And both question that if society is male dominated, it means one gender is privileged over other. It is not so much about biological predominance as much as gender, which subordinates the other gender. That's feminine, right? So it's gender which is being challenged here by feminism and gender theory, which is a recent development which is connected to feminism. All feminist activity, including feminist theory and literary criticism, has its ultimate goal to change the world by prompting gender equality. The whole agenda, the feminist agenda, is to change nothing less than whole world by prompting gender equality, because whole world seems to actually seem to have a single system in place, namely patriarchy, where one gender is privileged, the other genders are considered inferior or secondary. The sixth point of convergence in these multiple approaches which feminist school has is that gender issues play a part in every aspect of human production and experience, including the production and experience of literature, whether we are consciously aware of these issues or not. Feminism questions that these gender politics, it points out that these gender politics are there inside, outside the text. It seems to shape the text, literary text. They may not be directly played out in the text, but they definitely are at the background or seem to underline the text. So gender issues and the gender politics. By politics, I don't mean party politics or electoral politics, or it's not politics in the sense of BJP versus Congress. The politics here, by politics we mean struggle, the everyday day-to-day struggle, the everyday confrontation with power, the everyday exercise of power, and that is what politics means. And so feminism is basically a political movement in the sense that it sees that the norm that men are better or superior is a political idea which can be questioned and even subverted. So this is what feminist literary criticism is. So till now we have seen what is feminism and what is feminist criticism. Feminism is a kind of social, global, almost you can say a worldwide movement for liberation. It's a freedom struggle which is not limited to particular class or particular caste or particular region or particular nation. It's a truly global phenomena of freedom struggle of genders. That is what feminism is. And feminist criticism, which is based on this global movement, seems challenges the patriarchy or the male dominated views of literature and male dominated world of literature. So that's what feminist criticism does. So let's look now at various phases of women's writing and also feminism. So Elaine Showalter, a very famous feminist critic, in her landmark book called A Literature of Their Own, proposes the following three phases of women's writing. It should be noted that women did not have freedom to write in the Western society. They were not given, they were not accepted seriously as writers. So students of English literature who study Elizabethan period know that most of the time they are talking of men. You don't find any woman writer being discussed in feminism. though the whole period is identified by the name of a woman named Queen Elizabeth. There is no woman writer which we study from Elizabethan period, strangely. And when we talk of neoclassical period, even then we don't seem to talk much about women. So English literary history has marginalized or silenced women. It has excluded women, just like language seems to exclude women. The example which I gave you about when we talk of Manas or Manushya, we don't think about women. We usually think of masculine, man, which means that women are not human according to this point of view. So similar thing seems to be happening in literary history. So Elaine Showalter, looking at literary history, says that the women's writing and feminist writings have undergone three phases in the period of history. The first phase, she calls, is the feminine phase. In the feminine phase, female writers tried to adhere to male values, writing as men, and usually did not enter into debate regarding women's place in society. Female writers often employed male pseudonyms during the period. Students of English literature would be familiar with the name of George Eliot, a very famous novelist, a woman novelist who took on the name of man. It's a pseudonym, it's a male pseudonym that she adopted in order to succeed as a woman. So in the early phase, when women started writing, they did not actually enter into debate or challenge about male values which seemed to predominate literary history. So we have writers like Aphra Behn or Jane Austen or Mary Shelley, who in their writings don't enter into feminist discussion. They do seem to even then still have their own point of view, which itself is something of assertion of their difference. So they are not overtly political in that sense, but even then they do seek to question the male norms by very act of writing, which was actually something which was forbidden, tabooed, or something that was considered purely a male domain. So by very act of venturing into male domain, it was a kind of political act, the act of transgression. But even then they did not actually overtly positioned themselves as feminists. So this phase is the feminine phase, the early part of women's writing. So let's look at the next phase. The second phase, which begins probably in the beginning of 20th century, is the feminist phase. And the central themes of works by female writers was the criticism of the role of women in society and oppression of women. So the feminist phase, according to Elaine Showalter, was the challenge, the criticism of male-dominated society. And they also questioned patriarchy. They actually asserted their own selves, overtly political in its bearing. So you may think of a very famous feminist writer named Virginia Woolf, who actually is considered to be one of the most important feminists of early 20th century, of somebody who actually raised the slogan of feminism. And a very famous book by Virginia Woolf is Rooms of One's Own. Room of One's Own is a very important book. It's a collection of two lectures that she delivered, and in which she questions that a woman writer does not have the same space that the men writers have. And she gives example of Shakespeare's sister, an imaginary sister which she has invented, named Judith Shakespeare, who, according to Virginia Woolf, was not allowed to express herself. And there was no place for her in Elizabethan society. So while her brother, and she is not less talented, not less creative than her brother William Shakespeare, but even then she is almost deleted from the history of Elizabethan period. So that is what patriarchy does. It deletes women from literary history. So one of the tasks of feminist criticism is to actually recover these deleted, marginalized, cornered voices. So in the second phase of women's writing, the feminist phase, women like Virginia Woolf, they openly challenge the idea of patriarchy and what it does to women writer. She talks about rooms of one's own, is by which she implies that women don't have room of their own to write, while men do have. So her act was act of finding a space for herself in a patriarchal society. Another very prominent ideas which Virginia Woolf gave was the idea of killing the angel in the house. She is responding to the question about her creativity, and she says that in order for a woman to be creative and for a woman to be able to express her creativity, the woman has to kill the angel in the house. By angel in the house is what Virginia Woolf implies by the stereotypical notion of how a woman should be, ideally be, in Western society. In the Western society, women were supposed to be angels, and they were supposed to be well behaved, well mannered every time, and they were supposed to be good all the time, while the same norms were not expected from men. So angel in the house, according to Virginia Woolf, is that representation, that image of woman created by men to marginalize, to suppress woman's voice, has to be killed. Only then a woman can find her true voice, her true self. So for Virginia Woolf, the act of killing this angel in the house was an act of assertion of her identity as woman. So these are two very prominent ideas which Virginia Woolf gave. So now let's look at the third phase of feminism or women's writing, is the female phase. During the female phase, women writers were no longer trying to prove the legitimacy of a woman's perspective. Rather, it was assumed that the works of women writers were authentic and valid. The female phase lacked the anger and combative consciousness of the feminist phase. Now, the female phase, according to Ellen Shoewalter, is the phase where the idea that women can be writers and that women's writing is valid and authentic is not questioned. It is accepted as a legitimate form of writing. It has a legitimate place of its own. When women have found a room of their own in a male-dominated tradition, it was no longer about assertion. It was no longer about combat. So, according to Ellen Shoewalter, this phase lacks this militant spirit which the feminist phase has, because in many ways it has won its battle. So it goes to the next level of interrogating patriarchy instead of just fighting it on forefront. So these are the three phases of women's writing, according to Ellen Shoewalter. While it's useful to look at women's writing in three phases, it's also very interesting to look at three waves of feminism. And we should be able to distinguish between feminism and women's writing. Women's writing may or may not be feminist, overtly feminist, but feminism is basically political, overtly political. Right. So feminism is more of a philosophical, theoretical, intellectual, creative approach to the world, while female's writing or women's writing is writing done by women, which may actually also, as in the first phase that Shoewalter talks about, actually may support patriarchy. right? So this is how women's writing is different from feminism. Feminism, some theorists say that feminism has three waves. It came as waves and it drowned the whole world. So these three waves of feminist movement, feminist theory and thought are what we are going to look at right now. First wave of feminism begins in late 1700 till early 20th century, and some of the important writers are writers like Mary Wollstonecraft, whose book A Vindication of the Rights of Women in 1792 is one of the most significant statements of the first wave of feminism. The first wave of feminism was basically a kind of social movement, right, which focused on very practical day-to-day issues like right to vote, or as it is called, suffrage movement. And some of the important activists of these periods are people like Susan Anthony and Victoria Woodhull contribute to women's suffrage movement, which leads national universal suffrage in 1920. So it was in 1920 that women were given the right to vote. So there had to be a struggle for women to get this right to vote, right? So first wave of feminism was about getting very basic political right to express their political views. So it's a very important phase of feminist history. Second wave of feminism, which maybe begins from the early 20th century till 1960s or 70s. It is still very pragmatic in the sense that it builds on more equal working conditions necessary in America during the World War. It demands equality in terms of living conditions, and there were movements to form such National Organization for Women, NOV. NOV, or NOW, formed in 1966, cohere feminist political activism. By activism, we mean the overt struggle for your rights. Writers like Simone de Beauvoir, whom we will look in a little bit more detail later, and Elaine Showalter established the ground.